Love's gonna let you down.
When I was doing this photo session, I actually burnt my eyes, and I was actually ill for 3 days. I've got this thing called archive. The lights the guy was using were too bright. And at the time, you know, he was going mad because there was a tear in my eye, and he was like, oh, it's great, it looks really good. But when I got home later that night, I ended up in hospital. Love's gonna let you die. I don't like that because I look a bit evil in that one. I don't mind looking evil sometimes, but you know what I mean? I don't want to look evil. I wish I had longer legs. If I had longer legs, it'd be great. I could be a catwalk model. Love's gonna let you die. It's the bane of my life. Fashion dilemmas, eh? And there are people starving in the world. Bit done by someone, you know, and obviously it's not very nice when you've got a camera in your face. But the whole point of makeup is that, you know, it's an illusion, right? You get it on, you look much better than you did before, but no one knows quite how. So this is kind of giving the game away, really.
In the early 1980s, Boy George was a million-selling rock star, the controversial vocalist of Culture Club, and the most famous of the so-called gender benders. His following ranged from gays and grannies to teenage girls. The success story took a dramatic plunge with the breakup of Culture Club, Boy George's addiction to heroin, and his hounding by the tabloid press. But George O'Dowd is back in town and currently writing songs for his new album. In the summer of 1993, we followed him to America, where his version of The Crying Game had recently hit the charts.
I hope Quinton's in a good mood. Come on.
Building.
He's not buzzing us at all.
No, leave it. He said he would buzz us. That's what he said. I just spoke to him.
What do I have to say?
Well, ask George.
It's for a compilation album that's coming out. So I'll write a few things down. And I don't know, and maybe some other things that you can just throw out if you feel like it. If you don't, you don't. But I'm sure you can think of something wonderful to say. You always do.
I want whatever you want.
Good. All right, then I'll write it all down then.
When did you first come across George?
That day, I think.
That day. That day. When we all went to Mr. Warhol's home, or perhaps one of his homes, on 22nd Street or 33rd Street.
It was a studio, I think, and Bianca Jagger was there, and loads of other people I didn't know. It was nice.
All the old lags were there. All the people in the smiling and nodding racket. He rang me up and he said, come now. Boy George will be here. And I flung everything down. I ran all the way.
I can remember seeing The Naked Civil Servant when I was at school. And that's when I first found out about Quentin. And everybody at school called me Quentin the next day. That became my nickname.
Oh, that was funny.
That's why I've always had a soft spot.
I don't ever remember not being laughed at by my parents, by my brothers and my sister when I was a child, by the other boys at school, and by the people with whom I worked when I went out into the world.
I couldn't believe somebody like Quentin Crisp existed at that time in history. And I thought he was very brave, also very sad. It was weird because he was the opposite to what I was like. I mean, I was a fighter. You know, I wouldn't ever have been prepared to turn my cheek. You know, I think that, you know, underneath I'm quite gentle, but I've got a kind of very aggressive side. And I suppose growing up in a quite violent household, you know, it brought out that kind of violent side in me, you know, where I wasn't prepared to just walk along the street and be laughed at. If someone laughed at me, then I would want to fight them.
When you say violent household, how was that?
You know, just my dad was very violent. You know, my dad was always hitting us and always being aggressive. I mean, we lived in terror of his voice, you know. You know, you never really knew what kind of mood he would be in when he'd come home, and it really affected everything. There were certain things that, you know, certain kind of telltale signs that told me that my mum wasn't in a good mood. If I came home from school and there was still milk on the doorstep, that normally spelt gloom. And you could open the house and you could just feel the sadness in the house, you know.
I probably didn't treat Diane all that well. I didn't come in and beat her up or anything, but I was probably rude to her and things like that without realising what I was doing. And because, you know, this follows on from generation to generation. You know, my answer in life to everything was, if somebody confronted me, get them out of the way. Bust their jaw. Kick the hell out of them. Or else they kick the hell out of me. That was the way I was brought up. And sometimes I would sort of need to sort of scold the children. And you couldn't actually smack George, because he used to go into absolute fear. Right? And I used to draw back.
I always used to say to my dad, you know, if you're a man, I don't want to be one. I mean, that's what I say to him all the time. That if you're what a man is, then I definitely don't ever want to be like that. Because I used to get a slap.
He was quite a loner. He'd play on his own for hours. He was artistic even as a child. You know, he liked singing, dancing, performing. Always a performer, George. And as I say, he had a very soft side to his nature compared to, say, Richard, Kevin. They're more boisterous.
At what point did you realise that he was gay?
Well, he actually told me himself here in this kitchen, in that kitchen out there. We were having an argument. I came home from work and he dyed his hair blonde. When I walked into the back room, I saw this bright, really white blonde head sticking out the chair, and I thought, who the hell's that? And I went round, it was Georgie, and I went mad. I went, what have you done? So I said, right, I want to tell you something. You know, I'm different from everyone else. Like, I'm different from Gerald and David. I said, what do you mean? So he said, well, I fancy men. But I didn't understand anything about gays at all then. I had no concept at all of gay people.
Hello, in London. OK, we're going to do it now, yeah? So shut up, basically. Don't cut into us. OK.
Virgin Records, dusting off the back catalogue. At worst, the best of Boy George and Culture Club.
Fantastic. Do you like that? Hello. We love that. I think that's good. Can you also say for me, popularity breeds contempt?
Is he ready?
Yeah.
Popularity breeds contempt.
Move and move and
first excursions were when I was about sort of 10 and 11. I used to wander for miles. I used to be a great walker. I always dreamt of meeting people that were like me. Because where I lived in Eltham, there wasn't anybody really like me. I knew I was gay when I was 11. I think I knew before I was 11. All my friends were into pop music. I mean, I wasn't the only person into pop music, but it was how, you know, and why. I can remember, like, the first time I saw sort of David Bowie was on the Old Grey Whistle Test, singing Starman with Mick Ronson, and, you know, he had his arm around him. And I remember my grandmother was saying, oh, Puff does, you know, which filled my heart with joy.
Got sent home from school loads of times because he wasn't wearing the uniform. He used to wear a caftan to school and big platform shoes and things like that.
I don't care what the people say, I don't care what the people do, I can do what I want to do, whether they like it or not. I don't care what the people say, I don't care what the people know.
I know it might seem hard to believe, but there is people in this area who will tell you that when I was a youngster, I was quite outrageous myself. And, I mean, just after the last war, you know, I had a what they called a DA haircut, which was, you know, sort of down my back, and I would deliberately wear colourful neckerchiefs and pink shirts and things like that. And I knew people were going to pick on me, call me a puff and all, and it happened, and I was only a little guy.
When I didn't go to school, which I didn't a lot when I was like 14, it was like a whole year where I just didn't go to school, you know, because I was always getting in trouble and I hated school, I didn't want to be there. My dad used to take me to work with him, because he loved having company, he loved having someone to talk to, so he would take you around in his Bedford van. You'd stop at like 100 greasy cafes where he knew everybody, and you'd eat, like, you'd just be eating food all day and drinking tea all day and, you know, meeting all these really bizarre characters.
Are you pretty, baby? Staring at the boy. Gonna tell you something. You will get no joy.
There was girlfriends all over the place. There was lots of boys as well. He had mates of both sexes. But the girls were definitely attracted to him.
I think I did actually like girls for a little while. I mean, I tried to like them, and I did have one girlfriend called Shelley who, you know, I sort of got sexually aroused with. But I think just both of us were too scared. I mean, I remember one particular night where it could have happened and I just couldn't do it. And I always used to think that that was, you know, the turning point for me, you know, because if I could have done it, then I would have definitely kind of, I suppose, been able to do it with girls. I haven't yet. I'm not saying I never will. Because, you know, I hate the idea of living my life and never having kind of really experienced that properly. That's just me, you know, that's just me, my personality, you know. But I do prefer boys. I was totally wild, you know, I mean, I was, yeah, absolutely 4,000 times worse than anything that I've been ever since, really. I was going out dressed as Boadicea, I was sort of going out dressed as a nun, Carmen Miranda. Every day it was something new, you know. You know, I was wearing stilettos and skirts and...
Why the nun?
Why the nun? It was a good look. Was playing with the boundaries, testing the boundaries, shocking, getting attention, everything. You know, it's never one thing, it's everything.
So I remember in the 70s, I said to George, Bowie, he's cashed in on something. I remember walking down the street with George one day, saying it to him, he's cashed on something that's going to be huge. It's like this I think I called it unisex because it wasn't called gender bender then. And I said, something's going to be, so I said, somebody who cashes in on that is going to make a fortune out of that whole unisex scene, because it's just, it hasn't even begun yet. And I can remember saying, and I remember when I was after said it, about a minute after I said it to him, I thought, he's going to do this and he's going to be massive. I had this vision of what was going to happen and it all came true.
Live for the first time on Top of the Pops, it's Culture Club.
With the creation of Culture Club, George O'Dowd became Boy George. Drummer John Moss masterminded the group's commercial strategy. Less than a year after first coming together, the band made it to number one.
About early Culture Club was that the whole idea is about blurring boundaries. Culture Club were a multiracial group, and obviously if you listen to the reggae bass lines in Do You Really Want to Hurt Me, they're absolutely fantastic. And so you have a mixture there of reggae and soul and white pop music. And to have pop stars blurring gender roles, blurring with a blurred sexuality in a group which blurs musical forms is something that's very powerful. The form actually matches the content.
But first, a phenomenon that has outraged decent citizens everywhere, but whose music is loved by grannies and infants alike, be careful. Still throbbing at number one after 4 weeks, it is Culture Club.
Everybody talks about great singers, but they talk about George as a clown, as Boy George as a clown. I mean, I am a singer, and I don't think about the product as commercial. I write everything purely on a personal basis. I mean, the songs are egotistical in the sense that I write about the way I feel, about the people I love, about the feelings I have. I don't write with a commercial feeling.
So they're all first habits.
It's all luck, believe me. It's all chance, prayers, sleepless nights. It's all luck. You cannot write the perfect pop record. You just hope.
Really, and you were saying that it's an old tradition, isn't it? An older tradition.
Well, Karma Chameleon is an old-fashioned song in the sense that it's like a campfire song. It's for everybody. It's a song that you can sing along to. It's a very high-spirited song, which is what pop music is all about. It's about naivety and it's about excitement, and I feel that's what we do.
It's all about all of us. This song is called Victims.
I mean, I attracted little fat girls on the whole. I mean, you know, people, I suppose, that can relate to my vulnerability and my awkwardness.
Victims we know so well, they shine in your eyes when they can sense.
When the whole Culture Club thing first happened, George obviously wasn't gay to the mainstream public. There was no public acknowledgement of this. And in many ways, George, which is his prerogative, sidestepped that by presenting himself not so much like a girl, but a doll.
When you do the things on my puppet street,
and you look at pop stars who, say, do not have a mainstream sexuality, they are usually turned into some kind of neutered object. I think also if you're sexless, then you're far less threatening. I think as soon as you have a dick, you have problems. And eventually it happened with George himself once he started to go more public with his sexuality. And people don't like it.
I think I was safe, which is really strange because that's not what I wanted. It's never what I wanted. I wanted to be dangerously weird, thin, you know, with a shaved chest, out on the edge, wearing stilettos. I never wanted to be mumsy, cutesy, doll-like person, which is what I became. I think really what it was with me was that I wanted people to like me so badly that I sort of ended up being too nice. You know, I mean, there was a part of me that really wanted to be like, lock up your sons, you know. And the reality was that I wasn't really like that. You know, I could never really have built my career on mystery, like say someone like Michael Jackson or Prince or David Bowie. My whole thing was about being accessible, and that's really why it worked.
The boy next door.
The boy next door with the difference.
On a dark night, wish we could spend it together.
I'm sure the cuddly image was something that George developed and probably the group developed because he wanted to be successful. And whether intentional or not, the effect was to soften the impact of, you know, an over 6 foot, often quite spiky queen.
One guy came up to me once in a club and said, "You don't defend gays." I said, "Well, because I don't believe anybody is anything. I think everybody should be, you know, if you aren't strong enough to stick up for yourself, tough luck." And he got very upset, you know, because I said I'm not a poofter in the paper. And what I meant was that I'm not, you know, a teapot, short and stout. And, you know, I am a man. I'm not trying to kind of kill some desire to be a woman. I mean, I'm totally a man. And when I go into the bathroom in the morning, I'm quite aware of what I am. And I don't feel responsible for any section of the community. I love everybody. Anybody who wants to like me, whether they're gay or straight or dogs, cats, you know, any budges, you know, any culture. I mean, I'll have anyone who wants me.
On the
set there. Oh, are
you
the man?
I'm the man.
Oh,
yeah,
that's
good to see you. I wait to see you.
So you're going to be really sort of different.
Yeah, I know. I'm different. I'll see you later.
Is he shy?
No, you know why? He didn't want to get it. He wants to get all the real excitement of you meeting on film. That's what I mean, on his film.
All right.
So that's why he doesn't want to get the big hello now. Is there anything you want him not to ask?
Yes, there is.
Okay. About going to? Okay.
Can you talk about drugs?
Okay.
I don't want to stop going to.
Okay.
Well, if he does, I just won't talk to him.
Okay, so let me just say that's the only thing you don't want to talk about.
No, I talk about drugs, but, you know, I don't want him to sort of get too, like, cheeky.
Okay. So leave it up to what degree?
You
Let's
know,
just tell him.
Third degree.
Because he loves to talk about stuff, so we should tell him how far you want to go.
Oh, I think we should let him do what he wants, and if he's rude, I'll tell him.
Okay, which are there certain other things that you do want them to bring up, like of some of the records that are out right now? Because they mostly know about The Crying Game and the enormous success of that, right? But do you want to talk about the new label? We can't talk too much now.
Whatever, I don't mind what we talk about.
Okay.
Would you like something a little natural?
Oh, no, no natural. Hookers, please. Make me look like a hooker.
Done deal.
Yeah, it's good.
You're gorgeous.
You know, we were looking at pictures about your career. There was one point.
That's some scary.
I think I have the pictures up there. I want to show you. I really like this look. And you know what? The look really was considered so outrageous back then. But now you look at it, every pop star has that look now.
Well,
I'll show you the picture I'm talking
heavy
about.
Heavy metal people took over from
there. Absolutely. Really.
They all started wearing makeup, you know, like you said.
Look at that. I put the biggest hit that you had.
Two.
And it's all through. Open mic's cue. Start to move.
How many $1 million did Do You Really Want to Hurt Me make for the record companies?
Ooh, I don't know.
Would that be a multi-$1 million song?
More Karma Chameleon, that was a bigger song.
It was? Bigger than Do You Want to Hurt Me?
It was number one for 9 weeks in the UK.
And a song like that, I mean, you became a multimillionaire almost overnight, true?
Not almost overnight.
You are a multimillionaire, are you not? I am sitting here on the couch with a multimillionaire. The thing that I never understood, so here Boy George becomes very, very famous. The image of Boy George is everywhere. George takes over America. Culture Club becomes huge. Your star is rising unbelievably. It's superstar status. And yet you always seem to be like with angst. You know what I mean? Oh, I'm going to break up with the band. I'm not going to stay with the band. I got to leave the band.
I'm a drama queen, you know.
No, but you are a drama queen in the sense
absolutely.
That if you stick with the music, the Culture Club was a successful entity.
Now, I don't know what. I got bored of it, though.
You got bored.
It was like a bad marriage.
But I would never
get bored. Sometimes, yeah, you would. You know, it's kind of marriages where, like, the husband makes the wife feel insecure. So yeah, but she never leaves the kitchen, you know. It's a bit like that. Culture Club was like too much jealousy, too much ego. When I met John, for the first 3 months it was brilliant. I mean, I've never met anyone like him. You know, sexually, philosophically, in every way, he was a brilliant person. But it went sour just as we were getting a deal. Well, just as we got a manager, just as things looked like they were coming together, he went off with this girl called Sam. And I hated her, and I used to chase her, and I wanted to kill her. And, you know, after that, I never could trust John again, you know, once I'd been betrayed. Songs were about John. I mean, you know, roughly speaking, they were about John, but they were also just about relationships. But I was in a dilemma because it was like, do I leave Culture Club? You know, this is my band and it works, and I really loved John as well, so it was like, I kind of forgave him, but I was never able to trust him again. So you can imagine what it was like being in Culture Club. What it's like being on tour with two people who fight night and day. I mean, there were great times. I mean, God, you know, we had some amazing times. But most of the time, it was just a nightmare.
Around 1985, something happened, and George turned his back on the doll-like image. It was as if he were no longer willing just to please his fans.
Just 12 months ago, George was given the very best in press coverage. But recently, the favours of the press have turned in George's face. Stories appeared saying that Culture Club's tour of the USA was a flop, that the band's LP wasn't selling, and that they were on the verge of splitting up. And on the personal side, there have been some pretty nasty stories about George's relationship with fellow genderbender Marilyn. Tom Brooke managed to catch the two together in New York and started by asking why George had missed the finale of that big show at the Harlem Apollo.
I didn't turn up for that.
You're at the party having a beer.
We even got drunk. I should have gone on stage, but, you know, I mean, I was supposed to go on stage at 9:30, and eventually I ended up going on at 12:30, you know, and I'm not really used to sitting around for, like, 5 hours waiting to go on, you know, so I just sort of went to the party.
How do you feel about the way the press has treated you in Britain? Because at one time, everything you did was documented in the papers. Now they're a little bit cool about you, aren't they?
I'm not really bothered about the press. You know, I mean, I love them and hate them.
His whole attitude was totally different. He was like a nervous wreck. I just kept thinking, like, no, something's wrong. And I couldn't put my finger on it, but I never, ever, in my wildest dreams, thought it was drugs.
I don't know what happened. I don't know what happened, but he just disappeared to New York, and he's supposed to come back, and he didn't. But I would get phone calls, really bad-tempered, and all of a sudden they got really slow. I couldn't get him off the phone. I was doing a studio project and he phoned me up in the studio. Yeah, you know.
It wasn't like I sat down and said, oh, I must try heroin. I just took it because somebody in Paris had it, bought a bit, you know, and took it. And then I didn't take it and then I took ecstasy. And it was just kind of like, you know, I eventually sort of started taking it quite regularly. And there were a lot of people using it in London at the time anyway. There were a lot of people using it everywhere.
And initially, the positive effects were, I mean, what?
Well, all drugs are about running away. All drugs are about escaping.
We're in Paris, and he said, oh, I've got to go to the toilet, you know. So we're sitting there with the manager and his wife and all these French record people. Oh, yes, where is Boy George, you know? So I don't know. I said to Tony, well, you know, where is he? He'd been like 20 minutes. I went, fuck, I can't, you know. Do you know what I mean? Like, light bulb. I thought, Christ, you know. Because, you know, it's sort of everything, you know, X equals Y, you know, circle. So I went to the toilet and I was saying, where are you, you know? And I heard him go, this like, ugh, throwing up in the toilet. And I thought, no, he's not being sick, you know. And I kicked the doors open, I pulled him out, I turned him round, you know, and his eyes were all pinned out. And it was really, I was very upset, you know, I wanted to kill him, you know.
I think the thing that worried me was that I thought he was going to die. That was the only thing that was worrying me, that, you know, drugs kill. And one of these days someone's going to phone me, or there's going to be a knock on the door and they're going to tell me he's dead. And if I don't do something, you know, it'll be too late.
The only time you really know you've got a problem is when you run out. And, I mean, just judging by the way I treated my mother when I was on heroin, you know, it made me realise how, you know, uncaring it makes you. You just don't care. You know, anyone that kind of challenges you, you just want them out of your way.
I even got in front of a mirror one day and I said, look, you've got to see, look at the state of you. But of course they can't see what you can see. And I tried everything.
Good evening. Two of Britain's best-known pop stars, Boy George and Marilyn, are at the centre of a big police drugs investigation tonight. Marilyn was arrested earlier today. He's now been charged with possessing heroin. The police want to interview Boy George, but he's disappeared.
Boy George was last seen in public at a pop show in London 10 days ago. He looked only a shadow of his old self. He has admitted and denied that he's on drugs.
David O'Dowd, is this story true? Is your brother addicted to heroin?
Yes.
You're aware that he has said today that he's as fit as a fiddle, he could run a marathon.
Well, I mean, I'd like to see him run a marathon, he's sick.
You, at least, are concerned for his health. You think he may die.
It's just purely that I thought if I make it public, then, you know, he may get a grip on himself.
If Boy George is watching this programme tonight, what's your message to him?
Just get better, I mean.
Boy George came to court more like a conquering hero than a fallen idol. But he acknowledged his guilt. He'd been snorting heroin for 6 months and paying up to £200 a week for the habit. He was arrested here in North London in a series of police raids codenamed Operation Culture. He admitted to police, "I've been really bad, you know." Today, he spoke with relief about the magistrate's attitude.
I was very pleased with what he did, because he treated me like a normal person. You know, I mean, I've got a lot of money. He could have fined me thousands.
O'Dowd family, another incident involving drugs adds to their troubles. Boy George had a highly publicised heroin habit. His brother Kim.
An American musician who's been working with the pop singer Boy George died from a drug overdose.
Whose body was found at Boy George's luxury mansion in North London 2 months ago.
Boy George, looking tired and his head shaven, arrived at court with his mother and was the first to give evidence.
The Hampstead house was searched by police, but they found no drugs.
Two alleged Boy heroin George suppliers who are said to have fueled the addiction of pop star Boy George have appeared in court.
Boy George, who spent a couple of hours in the court building this afternoon and is expected to give evidence tomorrow, became the most famous victim.
Do you really want to hurt me? Do you really want to make me cry? Do you really want to hurt me? Do you really want to make me cry?
I found the whole heroin saga and Fleet Street saga of 1986 as being fantastically unpleasant. George was partly to blame in that he was one of the first generation of stars to really benefit and exploit the opening up of the media, and particularly the tabloid newspapers, in the early 80s to pop music as part of their move from newspapers to sort of entertainment, really, which is what they are now. And if you caught Fleet Street, then it's very much a Faustian contract. There's a time when they will want to run coverage on you, which you do not want.
What finally made you seek treatment?
Well, I lost a very important friend, and I think that was a real bang on the head for me, and it was like,
I mean, it's sad that it takes something like that, but it really did affect me. And, you know, a lot of people around me are still very ill. You know, I still see people who have problems. And I don't scorn them, you know. I just think it's really sad. It's very tragic. And, you know, I think that's the problem with the media, that they don't really understand what the problem is. They just see it as something very sensational, you know. Do you really want to hurt me? Do you really want to make me cry?
Met you, you had scars much deeper than my own. I know I was weak, but I feel like I've grown. In the back of my mind, I know the difference between wrong and right. So if you decide to leave, I won't put up a fight. I specialize in loneliness. In loneliness, I specialize.
You know, he got over it because he's got a lot of people around him that care for him and love him. Sometimes. You know, you did go through hell. I mean, I was there throughout the whole thing.
When you say going through hell, what do you mean?
Well, you know, I mean, anyone that takes that amount of drugs and then has to come off of it, it's, you know, it's not an easy task. You know, it's, you know, and then they give you, you go onto downers and tranquilizers, which is even harder to come off of than heroin.
This is Guarana, which is, you know, sort of Mother Nature's pick you up. And so I've got some stuff for, I've got an underactive thyroid, so I'm getting that, taking herbs for that. Go away.
His family helped an awful lot. But in the end, it really was down to him. There was a lot of outside influences, you know, the press and, you know, his manager, and you know, there was everybody wanted to see him get better, as far as I could see, except the press. You know, they were the ones that were trying to, you know, waiting for him to drop off. You know, and you know, he had a lot of strength, and he got through it.
And you've been living together for how long?
I think it's about 7 years now. But I did have my own flat about 3 of those years, where I used to go to whenever we'd, you know, usual couples arguments, you know. I'd pop down there and he'd stay up here, you know. It was just down the road, Hampstead.
Wish I could take it.
Look at me and say I'm a victim of desire. A hypocrite and everyday the ordinary life. Scars of my deceit, I will take to my grave. I know I've told you many times, this is the wrong way to behave. Doesn't happen every day.
As I've got older, I've been trying to find some space for myself and be able to put your foot down and say, look, I can't do that. I'm not flying all the way across the world and doing a concert. And of course people think you're being difficult, but actually at the end of the day you do have to end up protecting yourself, because there isn't anybody else who's going to do it for you. It's like trying to connect being artistic and creative with making money, and the two things are just so separate.
Weak attract the lonely and the lust attract the free. The moves are never easy, but there's plenty of love for sale. You are frightened by rejection, you're so scared to be alone. You act like you're so free, but you're just waiting by the phone. Doesn't happen every day.
Combined fashion and cooking. I never used to be able to cook anything. You know, I just basically cook for myself. Michael rarely eats in this house, you know. I don't allow any meat or animal products in the house. So, you know, I try to keep this house like karma free, because it's like, you know, you can't be a vegetarian and have meat and animal products used in your cooking. You know what I mean? You can't have like a lump of, you know, it just doesn't work.
Good to have you in New York again.
Good to be here.
Yeah, Julie.
Yep.
Hi, how are you? I'm
out of camera.
Oh, okay.
Good.
Is my lunch is here?
Yep.
Okay. Thanks.
Good timing, huh?
So you want, Tony, are you hungry?
No.
You want some vegetables?
No, I'm going to have lunch later. It's fine.
You sure?
Yeah. Yeah.
Got some vegetables?
No, definitely not.
No? Okay.
Yeah.
Huh?
Well, I'll tell you what the meeting's about, right? We have got with us the compilation album.
Great.
Right? Which you've got here. George, have you got any tapes or not?
No.
Okay, this is George and Culture Club, right? Mm-hmm. There are two. There's that and a...
There's going to be an EP which has got some remixes of Generations of Love and a track called Love Hurts, which was on the last album, which you probably haven't even heard.
Right.
And then there's probably going to be a new track which will go with it. In England, that's what we're doing, putting out the EP with the album.
This is super.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
I love this.
Yeah.
Why don't we get this out for Christmas?
Well, that's what we're doing in England. They're
great.
TV advertising it.
You got that here?
Yep. And see if Francis would like to come in. So I had a meeting with the, Tony, I had a meeting with the video jukebox, the box.
Yeah, right.
The crying game is still one of the most requested videos on the box. So we could put this out possibly for Christmas, Francis.
Look at the songs.
And since the crying game, the alternative radio, everybody's putting all these songs back in.
Right.
Which is great.
No, I know, the old songs can be
yeah.
played, yeah, I know that.
Right time.
I know.
I go to those meetings, it makes me really, really nervous. I feel like I'm going to throw up.
Why?
You know, it's like a bit like being on jukebox jury. It's like all these people, like the music starts to sound weird, you know, like it doesn't sound as good as it did when you made it. You know, everything sort of sounds like it's wrong and awkward. And you feel like, you know, like it's not good. You just really sort of start to question your talent and your, you know what I mean? It's just so weird.
I love that. Yeah. How would that be for Christmas? It'd be great. So.
In the desert, Josh and Mia, they put Kankan in their hair. At the Westerners, they stare, hurry, hurry, hurry. Paint a T-lock on your brow, open like a lotus flower. It's time to check your karma now, hurry, hurry.
Hare Hare, bow down, mister. Hare Rama, Hare Krishna, bow down, mister. We say Rama.
I think that in essence, you know, all the people that are drawn to Krishna consciousness are drawn to the kind of community and the sort of safety of Krishna consciousness. It's like when you look around you in the world and you see all the suffering and all the pain and all the confusion, it does make things very simple. In a way, so does Christianity, so does a lot of religions.
What about George and religion now?
Well, of course, I mean, it's changed two or three times. I just keep telling him he's a Catholic. I didn't ask to be a Catholic. I've asked him, you know, spoke about it to him, and he finds that Krishna is very calm. And I think that's the fact that they're not warlike, or, do you know what I mean? Because he's definitely calming down, I think, a lot. Like, he's learning not to shout and holler so much.
When we were in Italy, I was really shouting because I didn't want to go out to eat at the Krishna temple. And because we'd already eaten there the day before. And, you know, it was just like too many religions for me to cope with, because it was like we went to the Vatican as well in the same day as going to eat at the Krishna's. And it was just like, I was like, what the hell is going on? I just could not cope with it. And George was at the front of the Vatican, like, making me pray. He was like, say a prayer. I was like, you know, so I just like had to get out of there.
One of the first things that I liked about the devotees was the way they looked. And when I was about 17, I remember seeing them and thinking, wow, they look brilliant, you know, and beautiful. I mean, I love men with shaved heads. And, you know, I like that innocence. I mean, I'm very attracted to innocence. One of the most attracting qualities, I think, in anyone is vulnerability, which I kind of have, but I hide it well. And I think that, you know, I just love that. I think it's really attractive. There have been some couple of swamis, which are the kind of higher up priests, who have kind of taken me to task about my sexuality, you know. One of the swamis, who I won't name, said to me, you know, that it was harder for homosexuals to enter the gates of heaven. And I just said, yeah, especially if you lock them.
You're the first in line.
Oh no, that's real. From the house of Chanel.
I've always said that, like, being gay was like a real saving grace for me, because I think if I wasn't gay, I would probably end up really, really establishment.
Quite apart from getting the makeup right.
What do I see? My own sad reflection staring back at me as a lyric to a song. It's a weird thing, you know, because I am a big head and I do love myself, but then there's a part of me that just hates myself too. I've got much better. I mean, part of the whole spiritual thing, part of the whole religious thing has really helped me to just lighten up. To realise that it's not important if people don't like me. I mean, I always said when I was younger, if you don't like me for what I am, then shove off. But of course it wasn't really true.
Weakness is my child, kicking in the womb, crying all the way from the cradle to the tomb. See your mother's tears rolled down from her sad eyes, wishing you could change your life. Talk about my destiny, I don't understand. Fate it is too obvious for every angry man. All things wise, hidden behind my eyes, all things wise. All things wise, hidden behind your eyes, all things wise.
I'm not going to do any more to All Tell Me You Love Me.